One time, check. One time, chill, chill, chill.
Only originate, never pirate. Only originate, never pirate. Only originate, never pirate. Only originate, never pirate. Only originate, never pirate.
It's time to get busy and
only originate, never pirate.
Bust it. It's time to get busy and
only originate, never pirate.
Bust it. It's time to get busy and
only originate, never pirate.
No London Posse in the place.
You lucky people, we've got a very special show today for you. I'm going to be talking to two guys who are particularly influential for my taste in music. They made a ton of records from about 88 to 92, spanning hip-hop, house, acid, breaks, hardcore. Really stood out to me on the Pirates I was listening to at the time. And they went on to do a lot more stuff as well, which we'll get into later on. Welcome to the show, the Blapps Posse, and in particular, Aston and Jason. Hi, guys.
Good afternoon, sir.
Hello there.
Oh, okay, Jason, Jazzy Jason, of the Blapps Posse, and other things that we'll get on to shortly.
Sure.
Where did it start?
It was 88. Before that, we was me and some work friends were going into a small studio in South London called Noisegate, which was run by Double Trouble, and it was set up as a DJ studio, which I suppose, you know, it was right place, right time, really, because we didn't have any equipment. We wanted to make music. We found this studio that was run by two young people that were making studios for, you know, there wasn't like a DJ producer scene then, so, you know, they were in the right place at the right time. They had a studio where they wanted to make their own creations, but they also hired it out. So we found out about this studio and we went down with just records. All the equipment was there already.
Yeah.
I suppose it's nothing different from what you do now.
You go around with your record and sample it.
Exactly, and then keyboards, and it was all pretty basic stuff. I think it was about, you know, 10 seconds of sampling time. So if you wanted to sample something, you had to speed it up really fast, grab your sample, then slow it down.
That's how I met Jason, from going working in the studio. I got a job working in these guys' studio, Double Trouble, and that's where I met Jane. And I'd heard all these tunes beforehand. I'd never met him. I was like blown away by who's making this music. It was like, you know. So this sample had like 8 seconds. You had to speed everything to 45. And then when you actually sampled it, you had to record it all on tape. And you had to press you had to press something on a keyboard to make it loop, but you had to manually do it. It's like really bizarre.
So Double Trouble, that would be presumably where the tribal bass connection might have come from originally, the roots of that.
Further down the line, because what happened was, obviously, Double Trouble were running that studio. We were hiring it, and at the same time, they were recording with Mike West.
Rebel MC.
Rebel MC.
Right.
So what happened was, I recorded maybe about two or three EPs there, and at the time, Aston was working in the studio, and then Double Trouble used to do the engineering, they were the engineers. When you booked the studio, they were the engineers. But they became quite successful and were doing a lot of touring.
Yeah.
So Aston was like the new guy for me that was doing the engineering. So I was starting to work with Aston. And at first I was like, I don't want to work with this guy. I want to work with the blokes that are running the studio. But then Aston started playing me his music. And I was like, this little kid's doing this music, it's like amazing. So that's when I said to Aston, you know, like, I can't do all this on my own. It'd be nice to work with somebody who's got the same kind of we just had the same kind of taste in music. We did seem to make a lot of tunes together without much arguments, you know, about what was should sound right and what doesn't.
I went there because I had these friends of mine. They were coming over to my house, and we were like in my bedroom, and I was recording it on cassette. You know, that's how you know, like on cassette tape. Like I'd be scratching up the breaks, you know, those ultimate break sort of thing, you know. And they'd rap, and I thought, you know, let's try and find a studio to put this down properly. And it kind of developed from there, and I started going there, and at the time Jason must have been going there, and you know, it was kind of, the good thing was, it was like a melting pot of a lot of early, like, part of the rave scene, lots of SL2, you used to go down there, and we used to do loads of, like, adverts for pirate radios, and, you know, back in the day when everyone had a telephone that was the size of a box.
We brought out records before, and Michael, you know, did the engineering. It was a case of, can I sample this, and, you know, he was all hands-on, and you never got to touch anything. It was all what he did. But once we came away with a product, then we would go to JTS, Jar Tubbies, who used to press up reggae dub plates. So we went to Jar Tubbies and pressed up, because before that I was pressing up mixes onto dub plates to play at my own parties. And there wasn't many like dance acts doing that. It was predominantly reggae artists that were going to Jar Tubby and getting test pressings. So all the productions we did in Noisegate, we would take to Jar Tubby's and he would press up dub plates and get us a run of 1,000 copies, which we would sell straight into the shops. We would just hit the West End and just sell the records. You better clap it on tour. That's what I'm asking for. You say you got style, I got more. You stand against the wall. Don't make me joke. I'm serious. Time's a joke. If you want to party, move on in. And if not, then go spin. It's you I'm talking to. You know you whack. Just come to your senses and just don't hold. I've actually got a tape from Fantasy FM in 1990. It's DJ Hype playing a Blapps Posse record and talking about being given it at Trends nightclub, which was on on the corner of Shacklewell Lane and Amherst Road, Hackney. Yeah, well, I'll tell you something about DJ Hype. Before we was making music, DJ Hype, because we're from like Balls Pond Road, Dalston, that area, you know, me and the members of the Blapps Posse that went to school together. DJ Hype was the local DJ that everyone used to look up to, and he used to, you know, and I think he used to shop in the same record shop. I was always hoping to try and catch him there. I was told he shopped in the same shop, which is Mr. Music in Dalston. So DJ Hype was like a local hero for me as a DJ.
He was a hero for me too, and I was all the way over the other side of London.
His skills back then were just something that, even back in the 80s, I was thinking, I'm never going to be able to scratch. As you know, I always felt I was two, three years behind him, you know, in trying to teach myself. So you know, that's Hype. But I think Hype might have met Dazzle D in a club, because I remember where you were saying he met Hype, you know. But
that sounds like a sort of club Dave would go to.
I've never met Hype, but I've got nothing but respect, and he probably doesn't realise, you know, that I used to go to the same record shop as him, hoping to catch him there, you know.
So I think before Don't Hold Back, did we do that Break Freak record beforehand?
The Big
Freak. Remember that geezer Valentine used to do his own echo? I found this rapper somehow. He used to send demos to this tune. He sounded all right. And basically, his name was MC Valentine. And when he used to rap, he used to, like, instead of, he used to do his own echoes and delays. Like, so you wouldn't have to put it, you know, well, you know, we say, don't need to do, like, bye, 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 bye. Dad, you know. He did it himself.
That's brilliant, yeah.
Right, so the Blapps Posse, who exactly was in it? How many of you guys were there? And what did everyone do? What was the roles in there?
Well, when I first met Jay, he was doing, it was Dynamic, well, it was under the Blapps label, wasn't it? It was Blapps was the label. I don't think it was a Blapps Posse as such.
The Dynamic,
but it was Dynamic Governors.
Yeah.
That was the first act, right? Dave was, Dazzle D was the rapper and co-head in the studio. And there was MC Untouchable. He was another rapper. There was ST, there was another rapper.
We went to school together, we grew up together. So we started off as DJ, like most people started off DJing at parties, and Dazzle D DJed alongside me. We DJed together. He was DJ more than MC, but when it got to the stage where we wanted to record vocals, you know, we grew up together listening to rap and going to Covent Garden and attempting to break dance and stuff. So, you know, that was the core of the Blapps label. But when Aston got involved, you know, Aston brought in, like I say, he brought in Valentine and Louise, a singer that he grew up with and knew. So it made sense that we called it, you know, it was a buzzword at the time, Posse. You know, we wasn't like a gang of street hooligans. Yeah, we wasn't. It was just trying to create the idea that Blapps could be like a collective. And I had the, I don't know about Aston, but I had the notion that you could build a label. Like it was a small label, and it would be good to be like a big label on a small scale, and have a collective of people with the same goal of having music, singers, songwriters,
and it was a very strong identity as well that the label had. I feel with that right down to the artwork and the drawings, which I was going to ask you about, because that's a big.
It wasn't. It's nothing intentional. It's because it was so small. I used to draw the labels before,
right?
You know, so we had to have some artwork. We wouldn't know where to go to get somebody to do that. So that's, you know, it I suppose it looks kind of, when you look back, it looks kind of cute. You know,
it looks off the era, man. It's a time stamp.
Yeah, it is. I mean, it's all like necessity is the mother of invention, and that it was important that we kind of kept costs low. So it was all handwritten.
Yeah, I know
stuff.
That one.
Yeah, so I mean, it's a lot. It's changed a lot, but it's kept the same a lot now. You know, there's you don't have to. A lot of people got equipment in their house, and you know, we didn't have that. So the studio money that we spent was probably our budget. So everything else where we could trim some costs, that's what we would do. And it was the artwork. I'm not certainly not any kind of artist, but it looks. I suppose it looks. Well, people look back on it with affection.
Actually think Junior Boy's Own maybe took a little bit from that to make their image.
No, I think at the time we were all influenced off of each other. You know, we were listening to what other people were doing. I'm sure people were listening to what we was doing. It was quite a nice time for music, you know, back then, because there were a lot of people creating stuff without, you know, I think it's harder for young people today to bring out music. Yeah, that's it. So we didn't have any models to follow. We were just doing our own thing. And like I said to you, I think when I look back on it, I think everything that was successful from my point of view was right place, right time. You know, just the era was right, the time was right, and it just fell into place. It was never ever planned.
Was it a kind of a quick, a natural kind of progression into like being?
It grew so quickly. I think I took for granted, personally, I took for granted, you know, the position that we got into and where we got there. It's like the very first set of pressings we got, we took them straight up the West End. Somebody, Chris Forbes, who was a DJ on Capitol at the time, obviously went to the record shop on the Friday night to do his show in the early hours of Saturday morning, played our record on his Saturday night show, and he played it while I was still stamping, because the first release was just white labels when we physically glued on the label onto the record.
Right.
So I was in my bedroom at like 1 o'clock in the morning sticking stickers on the first Blapps release, and I just had the Capitol radio on, and he played the tune, and once he played it, then a buzz was created. It was reviewed in magazines, and it just went from there, and it's, you know, it's just totally pure luck, I feel.
Well, you're talking about the Acid Jackson. Yeah, well, it's funny, so I say, I didn't know Jason then, like, when I first got my job working at Noise Gate, so Michael was showing me how to use equipment, and it was, I think it was all recorded on tape, like 8-track tape. And I was just like, when I heard Acid Jackson, I was just, this is just amazing, and I just couldn't stop listening to it, and like, you know, and I thought, wow, do you know what I mean? So we made just a break for it in this tune, the MC Valentine tune. It was all samples, you know what I mean, because that's what we grew up, it was like, you know, our love of hip-hop Yeah, it was our love of hip-hop and a fusion of the house. And that's basically what a rave turned. It was like a fusion of... Obviously, like, from Europe, you had more electronic, like the R&S records, like the Joey Belchams and all that sort of stuff. So that kind of had an influence as well. But I think UK producers, because we grew up listening to, like, electro and, you know, kids of our generation were influenced by B-boy music, hip-hop, old-school music, and the sort of early Chicago house sound. That kind of fused, you know, it was like a fusion of all these things all together. So, like, when we made... So then when we did make Don't Hold Back, it's just, like, I remember... So this stab from, you know, going back to this sample that had, you know, like 0 seconds. So it was a stab from, I think, another Lynn Collins thing. And we just played it up and down the keyboard and added the beats. And then, you know, then Dave did his rap. And then, because I said, like, the maddest thing was, or the funniest thing now, is because we had so little time, sampling time, once we recorded everything onto 8-track, that was it. So all the scratching was done live onto the actual 2-track mix down. So there'd be quite a few takes of like, oh shit, it would jump, or like, you know, or some mistakes, I think, like, you know, but, you know, it kind of adds a charm to the music.
Oh,
like, you know,
does,
you,
yeah.
You don't know because you listen to it now and you think, wow, that sounds, you know, really good. And the same for Buss It as well. I mean, there was... And with the Acid Jackson, I think you actually record, because there was like probably like 4 elements to that track, so you could actually do the scratching. But Don't Hold Back probably had the most elements, and to start off with, you know, maybe like 10 elements. So all those tracks had been used up, so we had to record the scratching into the mix down. And I funny enough, remember the when we did the Buss It, you know, the first version, when it goes dim. Jam, like the second stab was a mistake. We sampled these 2 stabs, and I don't know what the machine did, something weird, but it sounded all right. And he kept it.
Happy accident.
Yeah, it was. It was definitely a happy accident. And like, yeah, and it kept the. It was. I think it was like a. It was some Roland sampler. But yeah, so basically, so we had, so in Noise Gates, when they had in the West End, so they had the studio upstairs and they had the studio downstairs. So by then, obviously, they had a bit more success. So, like, we used to have a lot more guys come in. These guys wanted to... I remember teaching, like, Top Buzz how to scratch and mix. You know, these Top Buzz... Jason used to come down there. I forgot the name of his crew, but Theo, who's now Fake Blood, Wise Guys, he used to be in this hip-hop crew, and he used to be come down there with his crew back in the day.
There's a lot of references to B-boys across your music.
Yeah.
There's a couple of on the Blapps catalogue. There's also, Jason, your solo stuff, the London Funk All-Stars. So how did the hip-hop world feel about Blapps? Well, how did they kind of accept you, if they did, even?
I don't know if they accepted. We were, like, making dance music just inspired by hip-hop, you know, and I think groups, labels like Musical Life, you know, had a British flavour rather than an American... You know, there was, at the time, you did get a lot of UK artists who wanted to sound like they were Americans and do American style, but Musical Life was really good because it was a very... had a UK identity... But I don't think we were catering for a hip-hop audience or anything like that. It was more like, we didn't really know.
There were straight-up hip-hop tracks on the B-sides of a lot of our... What happened was, like I say, we got caught on the crest of a wave where our tracks were blowing up in clubs, and it was quite a nice scene at the time. You would have a Marley Marl fast hip-hop production like Wrath of Cain or Set It Off playing next to like a straight up house song. So you know what, we were hip-hop boys to start with. That's what we wanted. They would have fit when you talk about influences. The Marley Marl productions are the things that, you know, we wanted to emulate. But because of like pretty much a tongue-in-cheek record, Acid Jackson kind of blew up with Rock the Discotheques, which was, you know, we were getting played in those clubs. So we thought, well, okay, let's keep the momentum up, carry on doing similar kind of fast up-tempo. We were coming from a hip-hop, we wasn't trying to do house, we wanted to go into those clubs, but we wanted to keep a hip-hop element. But there's no way that it was hip-hop, and there's no way that any hip-hop fans were ever buying them and liking them. But we did try to show on the B-sides that hip hop is where we're coming from. We would put straight up hip hop tracks on the other sides, but the distribution companies, like Rough Trade, were distributing at the time, and they were saying, don't put these songs on because nobody's interested in British rap and British hip hop. But we were running our own label, and we kind of was the mentality that we don't care, we're doing our own thing, because we'd already been drawn along on the crest of a wave where we could press up a record, go into the West End and sell it. There was no sale or return. They were giving us money for boxes of records, sometimes without even listening, because they knew my face. So when I brought in the record, you know, they were buying the box, not even listening. And in a way, I just took that for granted and thought, oh yeah, this is how it is. It's only when, you know, later on that, you know, when the record sales become tight, and then you start to realise that you can't take that for granted. But at the time, you know, that's what it was. So we were trying to cater in for a club where mixed music was being played. We did do some PAs in clubs where there were hip-hop acts, and hip-hop acts weren't interested in us at all. We did a show. Who did Bring Forth the Guillotine?
Silver Bullet.
Yeah, so Silver Bullet was in a club with us at the same time. And he was with, I think it was, not MC Duke, but that same era.
Overlord X.
Yeah, Overlord X. So we did a PA at the same time, and that was a hip-hop crowd. Whoever booked us for that, you know. We did actually do a Blapps Posse, you know, I only took down the MCs, but they were not interested. Blapps weren't considered as hip-hop at all, which...
Well, we weren't intending to.
Yeah, but, we were just making music. We didn't even think about it. We didn't think about any kind of scene.
I was going to say, you know, do what you want.
Yeah. Right, I was going to ask you about this track, because this track is one of my favourites.
Yeah, that track, and saying that, although it didn't really, obviously it didn't straight up hip-hop heads, it appealed to a bigger crowd, so we weren't, you know, and that became like a Blapps anthem as well with when they were doing the shows, because you'd have like four MC, you know, Jay used to MC one of his verse, you know, it was a good party tune. It's just like no one had really heard anything like that before.
That tune, like, regular listeners will know, I play that all the time on the show. The lyrics, they're spot on. It's really like all about accepting people around you, like don't look down on your nose on people because they're different, basically. So that's one of my favourite.
How many people wanna know when I flow, when I blow, when I show, I got a dojo, when I'm on the go, I roll, when I tell, when I'm mowing, niggas high, I low, so, then yo, preaching and teaching and reaching, and I've reached, stand up all night, yes, you get a bleach, not dissing, not fishing, not kissing, I'm hitting other MCs, who are out there missing, goals, and I roll HMO, keep me on, and in pole position, on a mission, my rendition, in condition, so there's just an anchor guessing, while I add, manifesting, they're like soul, take control, when the music takes a toll, on parole, on the dole, listen to some rock and roll, if you dread black, brown, or a blue suede shoe, it's up to you, so do what you.
So all of a sudden, DJs that I knew and that were playing our songs earlier were playing a new kind of music, and they weren't interested in what we were doing. It became very insular, and I see that with the UK hip-hop scene. You know, you couldn't tell anybody in the UK hip-hop scene about anything, because, you know, they knew it all and they weren't prepared to listen to anything. And, you know, I saw it again with drum and bass, and that's when I thought, I don't really want to do this music anymore. But Aston was already, you know, becoming quite successful. He's working with DJ Rap. So basically, I think that was Blapps period, right up until drum and bass.
Restricted, inflicted, convicted. Hold up your torch, we can scorch, have some fun. For having the gift and receiving that token. Just dance to the rhythm. Yes, bones can be broken. So listen, take part, be a sport, leave the fence. While I'm on mic, at your defense. So rip off your clothes if you're burning with favor. Explode into mode, don't save it for later. So do kung fu, jitsu, whatever takes you. If it relates to mic to the rescue, you can jump on a trunk or get paralytically drunk. Grin, giggle or grunt, or suck a razor blade blunt. Paint your face bright blue, roll in a canoe. Have a day at the zoo, or pretend you're a cook.
Do what you want to, everyone. Do what you want to. Let's have some fun.
everybody and everyone in a state of mind that God's designed. It's not ambient, yeah. So don't feel inclined to get drowsy. That's lousy if you're tight, go to Betty Bazzi. And if you're a guy, take a girly. But if you're a girly, take me, JT, in a place to be. Rocking on the MIC, doing it naturally. These are the lyrics I follow on the corny. You don't like them, wouldn't ever bite them. Well, I'ma tell ya, help me write them. Robin Wise with Layla K. Got to get the good, not really. That was a cold diss, doing what I wanted to, taking the piss. Bring forth the scissors, got my face in the purse, so I cut off the picture, stick them in my photo album. Girls come around and whack it out and show them it's impressive. Nevertheless, it's nothing less than bigger than average large. The posse in charge, I love Janet, not the bard. Much Kentucky's chicken sandwich, eat as many as my stomach can manage. Shut up and dance, rockin' Hackney, demon boys get tight and busy. But we are the Blapps Posse, doing what we want to, coming at a hybrid.
The big life deal.
Ladies with an attitude.
I remember Jake coming to the studio, and it was... He always listened to, like, the shut up and dance stuff, and he used to think, oh, my God, how does they get away with that? I'm going to do a tune, I'm going to take the piss. And it always seems one of these tunes, even nowadays, when you do less effort, when you less think about things, they're the ones that really do well.
Ladies with an attitude, fellas that were in the mood, don't just stand there, let's get to it, strike a pose, there's nothing to it. Ladies.
By this time I was in college, because I never, the music was never full time. I was in plumbing college in Hackney.
Are you a plumber?
Yeah.
So can I get your number after that?
I don't do plumbing anymore. My minions.
Right.
My boys will come around.
Do they do their own echoes as well? Like?
We re-plumb to beatbox. So me and Clayton are in college together, and I'm talking about I do music, and he's just a pure reggae head. He grew up listening to reggae, and I was playing him, you know, at the time, like SOS band, Prince Charles band, and Public Enemy and stuff like that, and you know, we started to bounce ideas, and I said I'd do stuff in the studio, and then he became another member of the posse, where he had his own ideas about stuff, and he created house music with the sit that you could tell that it was coming from somebody that grew up listening to reggae and dub. So the Outrage song was, he would have the two tracks on one side, I would have the two tracks on the other. We would help each other out on the tracks. Aston was engineering and you know, influencing as he did, you know, your vibe off of Aston. He's good to have in the studio when you're doing your own productions. He's generous in sharing ideas, and it was just quite a nice EP to make, but it was totally done as a joke. My girlfriend gave me £100 for studio time as a present.
I remember that.
And I said, this is the last £100 I spend in the studio. I don't want to do this anymore. And I went to the studio, and we did, what we used to laugh at, it was whoever was engineering Shut Up and Dance and stuff, we used to think that they were quite sloppy. I mean, when I listen back to ours, our stuff sounds sloppy and embarrassing, but we were listening to it and thinking, you know, how did them guys not tell that engineer that loop is...
The beat's not in time.
Yeah, it's really bad. And that's... And it seems to be getting faster and faster. And then, so I just said, I'm just going to put a Madonna sample over the top of this beat. And, you know, it was done tongue-in-cheek, but it was done with the same kind of attention that we did to all our music, you know, just do it and then just put it out. And then it just blew up again. You know, like Aston says, when you least expect it, something blows up. So then we sucked back into the house music kind of scene. What happened there is Big Life at the time licensed the track. We had to re-record it. Part of the deal was we couldn't use Madonna's vocal, so we had to re-record it. So they recorded it, and the singer Maria became another member of the crew. She joined, and we did more songs together afterwards. But that we were still pressing up our own original copy and did a remix with the original while we were still
the yellow one.
That's it. So while we were still signed to Big Life, we were still pressing up thousands of copies of the original.
A lot more people bought the original version than the Big Life version.
Yeah.
Outrage, too much energy, having arguments with people about this. I'm saying it's a baby. Someone else said it's a sheep.
There's a sample in there. Do you know the sample?
Yeah.
Sounds like a baby crying.
It's Blake 7. It's Aurac. It was like a computer that used to hum, and when he used to speak, and there was a humming noise at the background. And when it was an annoying computer, like a computer with a personality. And when it used to annoy people too much, they used to switch him off. And when he booted down, that was the noise of him booting down.
Brilliant.
So you can get it on BBC.
That's a better answer than I could have hoped for.
That was like probably the funniest record ever. I think this was the record Jay made with his £100. So he's trying to get everything, you know. It was like probably the last 3 hours he had, and they go, right, I'm going to do this. I'm really going to take the piss now. And too much
energy.
It was weird because it was like such a massive record. It's like. Also did the Turntable Symphony
on
D-Zone, yeah. And that stage was a bit more housey as well, because it had like a piano and it had a 4-4, although it still had the breaks in there and stuff. And yeah, definitely.
I'll be honest with you, I think by that time we were kind of going our separate ways in what the music we were producing. There's no doubting our influences, and there's no, as you can see from Aston's record collection, you know, it's old school funk, it's hip hop, you know, but sales wise, Aston was going down that route, because that's, you know, there's no denying that's where, you know, the money was, and that's where you could get, you know, some commercial success, and you know, this is a living for Aston. It wasn't for me. I had a job. So Aston had to take it more serious, and I think that time my heart wasn't in Turntable Symphony as much as previous stuff, and it had the Blapps element in as much as the fact that me and Aston were in the studio together, having a laugh, having a good time, throwing ideas together. But the pianos and all that, it was probably our most cynical record, if I'm honest, you know. It was straight up, let's do a tune for the house clubs. At the time, Big Life, Cold Cut were there, and Cold Cut were leaving to start their own label, Ninja Tune. And I used to bump into them at the studio, and we used to talk, and you know, they was aware of Blapps, and they knew what I was doing, and they asked if I had anything, you know. And I said, well, look, this is the stuff I really like to do, and I've done it at home. It's kind of like breaks and beats and slower hip hop stuff. Yeah, so they put out the DJ Tools, and then I did about 3 DJ Tools albums. So I thought, well, I'll give them 1 more DJ Tools, but I'll put extra stuff in it so I enjoy making it more.
The London Funk All-Stars, in particular, the triple vinyl, Flesh-Eating Zombies versus...
The Barnet Hookers from Mars.
Thank you, yes.
Like I say, I presented the last DJ Tools, which is Volume 4, and a lot of those tracks were mainly breaks, but about 50% of them were attempts, like nucleuses of tracks.
Right.
You know, I wasn't intending to make an album like DJ Shadow or Crush, but what Ninja said was, look, you've got all these tracks, there's enough here to do a Tools 4, but there's enough for another album. And they played me Crush and Shadow and said, this is where we want to put this. So the first London Funk album was just those extra tracks that weren't for, you know, so we had to, you know, I had to create another new artist identity. So London Funk All Stars, at the time it was just me just doing those beats at home. That second album, the triple album, was, you know, by this time, okay, so we've got a new identity, I've got a new reason to make music, and I'm making music I love, you know. So the second London Funk album wasn't breaks. It started, you know, approached it the same way, start of a break, but then start to create atmosphere and moods.
It's a joyful record.
No, that's what you want to hear people say. You want to hear people say that about your music.
Loads of live flute playing as well.
Yeah, no, I was getting in musicians and trying to, you know, give it a live feel. You know, I thought London Funk All-Stars, it sounds like it could be a live band, and that's what, yeah, that was where I was going with that. I was thinking it'd be good to eventually one day take this live and have, like, just funk musicians doing stuff that a hip-hop person would want to come and listen to, sure, music that a hip-hop person would want to rap over. Does personify that album and what I was trying, probably the most successful attempt at what I was trying to do at the time.
Jay also did have another adventure with another major when you did that track. The Clusterfunk tune, didn't you? Inside, what was it called? Inside, was it?
That was another label I made up.
What was the track?
It was Inside.
Oh, Inside, yeah, yeah.
Once I'd met the girl that did the revocal to Madonna, that, I think that was the closest to feeling I was going to be able to actually have a living out of music, because it blew up. About three or four labels were after it. It was played on EastEnders in the background in the CAF. I was thinking, when you played in the background of EastEnders, I think Ali was arguing about gambling with Pete Bill or something. My tune's playing in the background.
I don't think I'd have as much from the generation we come from. I think we have a lot more of a better, you know, better book to look through, you know, better history of music, because we're kind of kids growing up in the 70s and 80s, so we're influenced by that period of music, and those two periods are the most important periods of music, really, in modern music, I think, you know, because, you know, even like modern, you know, pop music's still influenced by 80s stuff, do you know what I mean? So like 70s and 80s, and obviously then you had the birth of hip-hop and electro, acid house, rave, whereas nowadays kids listen to what is now, you know, especially American, there's this EDM thing, which has got absolutely zero soul. By the same records from 20 years ago when I first started music to now, you know, so maybe that's why people, you know, want to hear it still.
Nice influences and you listen to good music, then I think you make good music.
lot of people know you, I guess, more by name, Aston, through the stuff that came after the Blapps Posse. You did a lot of stuff with DJ Rap under Rap and Aston, also Engineers Without Fears.
That's right.
On DJ Recordings, which was the label of...
That was my mate Sasha, who owned Lucky Spin Records. I met Rap at a City Sounds record shop. We used to go, Hoban. And obviously she knew my black stuff. And at the time as well, I was programming for Rebel MC as well. Because I programmed the Black Meaning Good album. That's one. I mean, I met Mike back in the day from working at Double Trouble Studios. And even back then I was working with him programming his tunes and stuff, and then he brought me on board to be his work on his albums with him. So I met Rap at City Sounds, and she said, oh, let's do a tune together. Oh no, she got me into remix. She did something or other. She did a tune, I don't think she put it out, and it turned into... No, that's right. But the B-side, I was going back to the B-side, is a tune I remix.
The B-side of
the one Jeopardy. Which you can't, yeah, whatever right. The B-side of Jeopardy is, yeah. And yeah, and then she played to a few labels and it came out on Suburban Bass. And that was my heading down to Romford period, you know, every 5 minutes.
And that was when the music was kind of changing very rapidly.
Yeah, that's when it started getting hardcore. Yeah, that's when it went to the hardcore phase and was hanging out at the Road Express in...
Lee Valley.
Right,
okay.
It was going all more Essex. Boogie Times was, you know, in the heart of Romford. Yeah, I mean, she was like the first big female DJ, you know, and yeah. I know not sort of to me, but she actually was really good. She was a really good DJ. Yeah. I mean, like, she was a really, you know, she was, I don't think of a guy or girl thing. She was actually just as a DJ, she was really good. But she was the first sort of female DJ that I knew anyway, really. I mean, there was a few, but not as successful as her, you know, but you can see why, you know, she was... You know, you have to respect the fact she was in a totally male-dominated scene and doing really well now. So then we did, you know, obviously the really big anthem, Engineers Without Fears.
Right, on DJ.
Yeah, now the weirdest thing is when I approached making that record, like the beginning of the record, so she did these strings and then I sort of filled in the gaps, basically. I don't know what she'll say, but anyway, so because that was my thing, you know, the beats were all in the Blapps and everything. So, but how I programmed it, I was like really into my house at that period, and house music used to do the thing where the beats would get louder and louder, just go from being quiet, you know, because you didn't have Logic back then, it was Atari, so you just do like a, you know, wherever you just draw a line. I remember like being really influenced by Masters at Work and all those, you know, a lot of those producers, even like MK, you know, New York, you know, American
New
house
Vegas
vibe. So, but the thing is they do these tracks where like at the beginning of the track would start and the beat would get like, you know, you hear the beat get...
Yeah, like a kind of fade up.
Yeah, fade up and volume. And that's like how why I did that at the beginning of Spiritual Aura.
Okay, and it makes it harder for the DJs to make
Yeah, that's it. But I was thinking more, I wasn't even thinking of that. I was just thinking I want to make something that sounds cool, you know. And at the time, you know, so I did that, and that's how I did. And I remember even like the middle bit, Rap was saying to me, oh, just make the beats just go crazy. So I just did the weirdest sort of maybe out of time but in time sort of chops on the beats, you know, and that track became like a, you know, a seminal hardcore record. I didn't think of anything like that at the time, and funny enough after that period we stopped working together, but right.
After the Rap and Aston kind of thing,
I'm guessing it kind
yeah,
of
I went all house.
Changed tracks
oh,
slightly.
Yeah. I went all house. Right. Still, I was programming for Rebel MC at the time.
And he was presumably at that time going more jungle himself.
Yeah,
right?
yeah, that's right. Well, then he formed Congo Natty.
Exactly, yeah.
And we were based out of a studio in Camden. And I'd just be doing loads of work, like loads of programming.
And would that maybe be where the Tenafly kind of
connection I met Tenafly way back when he did Coming On Strong. Yeah, I met Tenafly back then, but it was through Mike that I met Fly and Tupcat and all these reggae. But basically, it was like the who's who of UK and, you know, I met Beanie Man back in the day as well before he was famous. Do you know what I mean? Junior
the Barrington.
Barrington Levy. Yeah. Junior Reed. I met like everyone.
Actually,
you know?
The other day I was watching an episode of Top of the Pops.
Okay.
And it had Rebel MC.
Oh, right,
Tenfly,
okay. Oh, they did that. Okay, right.
Barrington Levy.
Wicked.
There,
yeah, that's a rarity.
All miming, but.
So, yeah, so that was kind of. But then my personal actual productions, I started doing. I was like making house at the time. Most of this project called Uno Cleo. Then I hooked up to this thing called Soul Brothers, this friend of mine. It was like this. And then that moved on to Freestylers. So.
Right, okay.
And I came back to my roots, obviously, with Freestylers.
Yeah, well, this is what most people now, most young people now, should we say, will know best from your career is the Freestylers.
So I met Matt. We were doing. Matt was making. Did record a name of Strike.
Strike.
Yeah,
did he
you
do
sure,
the,
mate.
Right.
Yeah,
you know what? I hadn't realised, okay. But I do remember Strike. It was on that blue covers.
That's
with,
it.
With
yeah,
the sunshine
yeah.
On
and
it.
Then
Mr. Roy.
Me, that's
stuff
right. Yeah,
on
yeah.
It as well. Yeah.
So and that kind of had a ravey influence with a cool. Well, you know.
Yeah,
anyway,
it's kinda...
so and me and my friend Andrew, we got signed to the same label, and we started talking about. You know, he knew my tunes because I'd been making music longer than, you know, obviously Matt. And then he said, oh, I want to do a track, not house, like something influenced by what we used to listen to. And we just made this track and we sampled this group, Freestyle Don't Stop the Rock, you know, Freestyle Rocking in the House Tonight.
The electro group.
Yeah. And it kind of that's when Freestylers were born. We kind of nicked the name as well,
okay.
And nicked the song, and it kind of, you know, and then we did
one
a piece.
Stop shop.
Yeah. And then so we released that, and it kind of went from there really. Then we did more tunes, and then we did the Tenafly EP. Funny enough, the two tracks we did, it was like an EP. So we had B-Boy Stance, and we had the original of Feel the Panic, that had the Aerosmith Walk This Way.
Right, okay.
And they both got banned.
Oh, right.
And they became collector's items, you know, because the Tenafly...
Because of uncleared samples.
Well, the Tenafly thing was to do with Oasis, because he sung the melody from the verse of Wonderwall. This was, like, cool. That's quite kind of why B-Boy Stance kind of came in a hit. They wouldn't allow us to use the melody. Tenafly changed the lyrics... but kept the melody of Wonderwall from the verse.
Right,
you know,
okay.
Today's going to be the day. Anyway, that was the chorus. And, but then, you know, people were jostling Oasis because they liked to, like, have a go at them, saying, how can you not let these guys, you know, blah, blah, their influence. Anyway, that kind of hyped the record, and that's why it kind of, you know... did better as well. It
right.
kind of made for the
controversy.
It kind of, yeah, controversy.
Helps, yeah.
It kind of went from the underground and crossed over commercially. And then the Aerosmith, they wouldn't let us use it anyway. So, but yeah. But yeah, so it's quite funny that like Freestylers kind of went back to what I was doing with Jay back in the day, you know, sampling, using my influences, sampling hip hop and sampling. Housey, fusing with house, and
that track's
and,
based
know.
Around the stalag rhythm.
But that was like a straight up reggae sort of thing, yeah. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. But that was a straight up reggae, hip hop feel to it. So, which was different because lots of UK rappers always tried to kind of apart from when Musical Life was around, I think a lot of UK hip hop artists always tried to sound like American. But sure. to me, it's always been the fusion of hip hop and reggae as a very UK identity that has, you know, grabbed people's attentions. I haven't tried to sound like an American because the Americans would be interested.
Exactly. You get shunned by the Brits and laughed at by the Americans.
You know why? Sitting a fire and a youth freestyler, switching all food while you're pitching all youngsters. If you touch a youth, then your days are the over, boy. You know, see your days are numbered. Ramp when a joker, when a skin teeter. Food while you turn up with your fuck, boy, a streeter. And if white tester, then they must get defeated. No surrender, I know defeat.
That's the first record I heard was the B-Boy Stunts,
yeah, okay, yeah,
which
yeah,
I guess,
yeah.
I'm guessing was quite near the beginning.
Yeah, it was near the beginning. Yeah. Well, we made that in 98, that record. 98. I think, end of 97. No, it came out in 98, something
yeah,
like
that. Yeah, and then, you know, obviously from then to now, you're kind of... you know, headlining festivals, being flown around. You were in, well, we played together in Tenerife,
yeah, yeah,
like not too long ago, but then since then you've been in Dubai,
yeah,
and
Dubai and India, yeah, and I go to America quite
you're
a bit
always
and,
over
you know,
there,
so,
yeah.
So obviously I'm always trying to, I have to work, and you know, I'm trying to, you know, set in the shit every day. I'll come in the studio. I know he recently put out a new album and stuff, so.
And how would you describe, because it what I was getting to, from the beginnings of the freestylers to now, it seems to have been quite a evolution in sound and equipment, presumably.
Yeah, I guess so. As I said, it's really weird, even if I make like something that's housey, although I like house, I always sort of feel like I'm making it with a hip hop edge to it. It's really
right,
weird,
okay.
But that's because that's the music I was so influenced by growing up as a kid. That's what wanted me to
that's
make
the
music, you know.
Going
so,
in your head.
And I said, like, so the first music I was making with Jace was, you know, speeding up hip hop breaks. I'm not like looking to be accepted by UK hip hop. I'm not, no, but
sure,
it's
yeah.
like. We did do one tune, which I think was really like a massive underground hip hop, was that Dogs and Sledges, which with Millie and Dan.
From Santa Cruz, New York, straight down to Pirate Head.
I don't think, you know, I'd say when I made it, I just wanted to make, you know, and the thing about Millie and Dan, you know, he's...
Demon Boys.
Yeah, yeah. From Demon Boys, and his command and presence and his vocal and his hooks are just, you know, amazing.
Holler for my dogs and sledges, I'm with every inch of chicken. You want in bro, go get advantages. You want your straight from the bridges. Papa like a pasta out of sell bridges. Very legendary just like Dan Bridges. Dapper just like Nema the Cornel Parridges. Head knock with me dogs and sledges. 25 mil and 56 bridges. Got me survival book 17 bridges. Very well equipped with 50 languages.
We actually had a really good hip hop tune on our brand new album. It's called with a young guy from Birmingham called Cynical, and it's called Who Got the Buzz.
Okay, whistle pussy, I want you to get busy, because this one goes out to all the hip hop lovers.
Say freestylers is yeah, it's electronic music based in the hip hop and reggae roots, I'd say, definitely. I mean, you get these, you know, it's just like, you know, over the years you get these people that go, I loved hip hop, and like, but like what you make is so far, so I can't
yeah.
For me, I can't fathom how you were ever into hip hop that hard. I still know today my music is still rooted in in my love of like samples and hip hop. And
other people might say it, but you listen and you'd think, how can you like hip hop but also like this
yeah.
new tune you've just made?
Funny enough, I've started doing this B-boy theme of the week on our Facebook, and this week I've put Arthur Baker's Breaker's Revenge, you know,
okay.
And after, you know, and I would say Arthur Baker, if I had 10 people that influenced my music career,
right,
I'd say he's got to be number one or two, because without Arthur Baker, there would have been no Planet Rock, no Looking for the Perfect Beat, none of these records.
Yeah.
They would have inspired, I think, other things. Before then, I didn't really listen to much music, and then, you know, you kind of listen to what your parents listen to, or, like, you know, and I heard these tunes, like, Planet Rock, what is that? That is just amazing, you know, and it's just like, you know, it's amazing, you know, like, you know, I've got to meet him and I'm friendly with him, and, you know, and we did a remix for him, and it was just like, you know, wow.
Full circle.
Yeah.
People now who may listen to your music and not know any of that, they might hear, you know, that's why I'm into funk music, for example, because you hear the hip hop and then you start to wonder whether, or you're in a bar somewhere or a shop even, and you hear a sample on the radio or on the CD, and you're like, oh wow, that's from that. And
you can
kind of trace everything.
You can't trace spotty.
Yeah, exactly. And when you're making music, I guess it's hard to listen to music.
That's it. I mean, I can hear like a pop record, and they use a snare. I know this is really geeky shit, and I can tell when that snare.
Exactly.
From.
Yeah.
If it comes from a break, like, I'll know that it come from Funky Drummer or Impeach the President,
yeah,
or one of these big, you know, but that's like,
it,
I think to be, I've always thought that to be a bit of a success at music, you have to be a bit geeky and train spotty.
Sure,
you know?
Yeah.
So, you know, to know, but that's maybe because I come from a different era. Now, I don't know, you know, nowadays it's like, it's a bit more computerized. I mean, I can't complain because I'm playing the game anyway, and it's amazing what I can do now compared to, you know, but as you can see in the studio, so, I've still got samplers.
Right,
it's kind of like hands on.
We're in Aston studio here. I can see three Akai samplers.
Yeah.
Three Akai samplers,
yeah.
And a computer which does the same thing.
But I don't actually use the samplers anymore. But,
you don't use the samplers?
No, and I've got a proper MPC 60 there.
You've got a couple of MPCs there, yeah.
I've got a Juno 106, which is the classic electro keyboard.
Yeah.
And I've got a Virus that was used probably on the Raw's f***ing album.
Okay, we'll bleep that out.
And I've still got the old Mac, but
and,
yeah.
And what's this?
The big knob. That's just like the big knob. It just helps you to record, switch between speakers and
like a patch bay.
Yeah, kind of. Yeah.
Got the Technics up there. And
got my turntable.
Rack of process.
Again, they don't get used because it's just all, you know, all in the computer now.
Right.
So
it's there for
aesthetic reasons. Yeah, that's it. So it looks like you just don't come into a room and you just got a computer. I mean, when I was working with, you know, we did some work with Rob from Pendulum, you know, he'd walk into this room and literally it was just a big computer. That was it.
Yeah.
You know, and that was it. There was nothing in a bedroom with loads of Coke cans. I mean, you know, that's before they made shitloads of money. But, you know, nowadays it's got a proper setup. But, you know, it just goes to show.
Keep on falling.
Just before we wrap this up, I wanted to obviously ask you about some of your influences and your favourite records.
Okay.
Party people, party people, then you'll get funky.
So I'd say Planet Rock.
Planet Rock.
Yep. African Bar and the Soul Summit Force. I'd say Mantronics, Needle to the Groove.
Okay.
I'd say No Way Back, Amando.
Adonis.
No Way Back. Whoa, what's that early? Everybody's in the play. One of those. What's that early? What was the first
thing?
Yeah,
Charlie.
Charlie. I'd say Charlie. I mean, the thing is, I remember when I first heard Charlie. Even if you listen to it now, it's just like, it was so far advanced. Forget that it's a gimmick record, because I'm sure, like, Liam made it. It's so far advanced of what everyone else was doing, because it had proper hook structure. It was, you know, and it was just so musical, and yet used some of the sounds like, and he did it all on a W workstation, just on a keyboard. Yeah, it's just like,
when that came out, they were, that was
was the first record I was aware of being like properly hyped on the Pirates.
Okay.
They were playing it everywhere for about, I'm sure it was about 6 months when they started playing it to when it was released. Because I was going into record shops trying to find it, and it just wasn't, you could not get it anywhere until everyone was in such a frenzy and then it was released. So, yeah, that maybe did catapult them a lot.
Definitely. And then, you know, records like Deep Down Inside, you know.
Hard Drive.
Other records like obviously Public Enemy, the Nation of Millions album,
sure,
the Cypress Hill album, Insane in the Membrane.
I was going to say actually B-Boy Stance,
yeah,
as well as it being the Stalag rhythm, Ring the Alarm rhythm or whatever, it had a boom back, it had a proper head nod,
it was like a hip hop, very
Cypress Hill kind
so of. Again as well, I like love anything by Scientist and King Tubby. When it comes to dub, they're like, you can't
master
get better
mixes,
you know, you can't get better. Scientist being Space Invader, you know,
they
influenced one of our tracks. What other tunes, like, there's so many, you know, probably like Future.
The acid,
all those acid tracks. Fast Eddie. Acid Thunder and Get the Yo-Yo Get Funky.
Sure.
There's so many records,
these are all the acid ones. Mm. These are all records that are really remembered, have stood the test of time. You hear them on this station, on Cool London, on many other stations. Okay. You turn on old school mornings generally.
Mm.
You'll hear them always.
You know, then you had all the early Andy C stuff, Suburban Bass, Long Dark Tunnel, Valley of Shadows. Yeah. I mean, I was like Beastie Boy. I mean, you know, I was like a massive Beastie Boys fan. I mean, that's the only group I ever went crazy for. I can see
a poster on the wall here.
I mean, it's such a shame that MCA died at such a young age, you know. But like, they were the only group I ever liked, and I got to meet them at the big day out, and it was just like, you know, yeah. Funk wise, you know, anything by James Brown, Kool and the Gang. Meters, all the record, you know. I mean, the thing is that the good thing about good thing about hip hop music back in the day, it kind of introduced you to all these music. Like, I never heard it when I was at 16, I never heard of Meters or Booker T and the MG, maybe from Green Onions, but like, not their underground cool stuff, you know, even like Led Zeppelin, you know, and all these mad, yeah. So basically, hip hop was really important. It's like a lesson in music. It really is. Back in the day, not now, but back in the day, from, you know, we'll say the golden period of hip hop, was a proper musical history. Because people wouldn't be afraid to sample anything. You know, you sample rock.
The more out there, the better.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, you know, when the levee breaks, that drum beat. When I first heard that, that was just like, what the hell? I'd never heard it before until I heard it into a hip-hop record. But yeah, you know, you hear these beats by rock, you know, but then it wasn't like mental rock. It was like, you know, I don't know what you describe Led Zeppelin, but, you know, they're amazing. You know.
Hair rock.
So you got Kool, and there are all these, like, weird jazz records that, you know, and the Ultimate Breaks and Beats compilations that formed the whole, you know.
Well, they were a massive influence on everyone. I mean, they were like a kind of one-stop shop, you know, a gateway to discover all these artists and go and find out what other music they'd done.
That's right.
And yeah, you got lots of vinyl in here. You got the bar case there. It's very old Scientist.
I've always looked after my vinyls.
Yeah,
I've got a bit of Augustus Pablo down here. I mean, what I've got is what I call my record making records.
Exactly. Yeah. The ones that live in the studio.
Some of them I'd play out.
Yeah. Now I was going to say this collection in here looks more like the influences records. But you play, when you DJ now, what were you playing on?
I just play USBs. Amazing.
So kind of CDs.
I don't even play CDs now.
just before we wrap it up, I've noticed a Blapps Posse page is now on Facebook. So does that mean there's something brewing?
There's definitely something brewing. I've remixed my own track of the sound, which is off the album. The new Freestylers album, I've done a Blapps remix because our manager wanted us to do it, so I got Jay back in, and we had a great time doing it. You'll get to hear it, and I want to do some more Blapps sort of stuff, so yeah.
North London Posse in the place.
Right, guys, thank you very much for talking to me, and I hope you've enjoyed bringing up some memories, and do it again soon.
Yeah, no, I enjoyed it. I've not spoke about this stuff for years, so it's nice to just relive it. Thank you.
Yeah, it's very good to reminisce, and hopefully we'll be back out there again soon.